Good morning. So let's continue this renormalization of Hannon maps. So let's recall briefly what we discussed yesterday. So a Hannon map is something of the form where this F is some unimodal map, and this epsilon is something very tiny. So that is the first coordinate, and the second coordinate is our simple x. But let's make a picture of what it means. So we have the square, the unit square, and what it, so the image of the square is something like that. So it's, and because the width of this strip is epsilon, it's a very tiny, it's a perturbation of some unimodal map. But what is going to be crucial, and we discussed this already yesterday, if you take a vertical big line of length 1, then that will be strongly contracted and will be mapped horizontally. So there is a very strong contraction. And the size of this is like the epsilon dy, which is much smaller than 1. So there is very strong vertical contraction. Okay. And just a reminder, the Jacobian of the map is exactly this, d epsilon dy. The Jacobian is also going to play an important role. And so because of the shape of the map and because the Jacobian is very small, vertical lines are going to be strongly contracted and put horizontal. So these are our maps. And then we wanted to renormalize them. And let's recall the definition of renormalization and of a renormalizable map. And so the situation of a renormalizable map is something like this. There exists a little tilted rectangle with horizontal top and bottom. And that will be mapped to something a little bent, and then it will be mapped back inside. Something like that. So this curve is going here, and this curve is going here. And the left. So these curves, they become vertical. And then in one step, they become horizontal. So now you see the trick. If you take the vertical foliation here, that will be mapped horizontal. So if you pull it back, you will get some foliation here. And these foliations, as we discussed yesterday, they are exactly the ones, if you take one of these leaves, they are exactly the ones which are going to be mapped by the second iterate to something horizontal. And so, and this fact that there is this foliation forced us to use a nonlinear rescaling to define the renormalization. So there is some map C1, which is a diffeomorphism, and we will come back to the precise shape of that one. And we will have here, after rescaling, we will get our renormalization. And the essence of this diffeomorphism is that it straightens the foliation to become vertical. And so psi, which goes in this direction, straightens. the foliation, and then the renormalization is defined as you do psi 1 phi, then you do the second iterate, and you come back. And so this is the renormalization operator on our Hendel maps. And then yesterday renormalization becomes very useful if this operator is itself hyperbolic. And indeed, it is hyperbolic. And let me summarize the statement from yesterday by a picture. So what's going to happen is there is the space of unimodal maps. And we observed yesterday, because of the Jacobian is very small, that the limits of this renormalization has to be unimodal maps. So in the space of unimodal maps, there exists, we saw that before, there is the unimodal fixed point. But now we go, and also what we have is there is has some stable manifold. This is all in the unimodal world. So codimension one stable manifold in the space of unimodal maps. And there exists some unstable manifold in the unimodal space. So, and because of this super fast convergence to the unimodal maps, because of the Jacobian, this hyperbolic picture extends, and it is really not difficult to prove, extends into the space of Hendel maps. So the stable manifold of this fixed point becomes the stable manifold of F star. It's just the notation is this map. It's the same map. Yeah. And so this becomes the stable manifold. And the original unstable manifold, maybe I should draw it a little bit like this, is still the unstable manifold of the Hendel fixed point, which is a unimodal map. And so we get exactly the same picture. And then from this picture, a consequence will be, again, universal parameter universality. I remember we had this pair doubling cascade going up to the boundary of chaos. And from this hyperbolic picture, you will see again that the bifurcation moments go to the boundary of chaos exactly with the rate 4.6, which is the unstable eigenvalue at the fixed point. And so, again, this is a boring picture. We get exactly boring, but it explains why people who do physics and engineering, when they see a cascade, they see the one-dimensional numerics. And so we explain something.
What's the regularity?
So this unimodal map is actually a quadratic-like map. So we work with holomorphic unimodal maps. And this epsilon is also something holomorphic.
So what's the topology of the convergence?
C0. But then you get everything because everything is holomorphic.
Can't get more than C0.
Yeah, so if you get C0 convergence in a holomorphic context, you get convergence in any topology. And so this is like perfect. It's perfect. Okay? So now let's go to the dynamics. Maybe let's recall something. If you take the Hendel family, you remember that was this one. And so, and that has a parameter space by A and by the Jacobian. So this two-dimensional parameter space will live somewhere here. So somewhere here, you will see an intersection in the Hanon family with the stable manifold. And so somewhere here is some little curve, an analytic curve, and here you will have the maps which are infinitely renormalizable. And that are infinite renormalizable maps we are going to look at. But you should think about these are maps in some codomains and one subspace. So let's look at the dynamics of infinite renormalizable maps. Not necessarily Hanon maps, but Hanon-like maps. So let's extend this picture again. So what you see is, so we have our map, and we have the boxes, which are exchanged by the map. Then we have a picture of the renormalization, which is obtained by some non-affine rescaling. And then we also used the map C1C, which is just the rescaling, and then brings it to the other box. So F of psi of V. So this box we will call BV, and this box we will call BC. And then this process continues. So we look again inside here. We will have again two boxes, which are exchanged by the renormalization. We renormalize, we rescale with our diffeomorphism, and we get the second renormalization. Okay, so and then again, you see a box here and a box here, which are exchanged, and then this process continues like that. And so and now, from this picture is sort of the key picture in the whole analysis. So it will come back all the time, and everything is happening in this picture. And the analysis is really mainly going to sit in these maps. So, but now let's look at the dynamics. Let's go slow, and let's not go too fast. And so these two pieces, of course, we are going to introduce cycles. So the first one are these two pieces. But then in these two pieces, we will see copies of those guys. So those guys, they will land somewhere inside here, and then they are mapped somewhere here. So these four pieces will be the next cycle. But then you go to the next renormalization, you have two pieces here, they go inside here, they go inside here. Those guys, they go inside here. Those guys go inside here and inside here. And you see, as in the one-dimensional picture, that you get this sequence of cycles. And so here there are two pieces, here there are four pieces, and here there are eight pieces, and you see it doubles each time. And then, of course, you take the intersection. So C is the intersection of all those cycles, and the theorem is that this is an attractor. And so if F is infinitely renormalizable, and then you can do this construction, and then CF is a counterset. And for every N, there exists exactly one periodic orbit in the nth cycle of period 2 to the n. And if you take a point which is not, these periodic points, they are of saddle type. So they have stable manifolds and unstable manifolds. And if you take a point which is not, in the stable manifold of all those periodic orbits, then the limit set is exactly this Cantor set. And so our Cantor set, which is living somewhere here, is the attractor of the system. Okay. So this is actually a sort of an old theorem by Gambaudot, Van Strien, and Tracer, in a slightly different context, but essentially it's the same. So in the context we are discussing, this is work by Di Carvalho, Michel Lubitsch, and myself. Okay, so let's start to look more carefully at this Cantor set. And so what happens is, and this is again by André de Carvalho, Michel Lubitsch, and myself. And the statement is that from now on we will always be, everything will be about an infinite renormalizable map with a tiny b. So there exists exactly one invert measure on this Cantor set. And this, secondly, there is a conjugation from the Cantor set we are studying here to the Cantor set of the one dimensional fixed point. And so topologically, and you can see it in the picture, this Cantor set is just an adding machine of like in the one dimensional case. And so the topology of the attractor is completely clear at this moment. And then there are this measure that has what they call characteristic exponents. So one of them is zero, and the other one is log of BF. So what it means is, I'm going to have to tell you what this log, what this BF is, but this zero characteristic exponent corresponds to the directions. In this Cantor set, there will be certain directions, and you should think about them as sort of tangent spaces to the Cantor set. And in these tangent spaces to the Cantor set, the dynamics is not expanding at all, neither contracting. And so there is a stable direction which corresponds to the tangent space. The other direction corresponds to the contraction. So let me tell you what this BF. BF is the average Jacobian. And so BF is e to the power, the integral of the log of this Jacobian with respect to this measure. And I put a box about it, around it, because this number is just the Jacobian, just the average Jacobian, is going to play a major role in a geometrical sense. This is an ergodic theoretical number, but this average Jacobian is going to play a major role in geometrical sense, which is already a little surprising, ergodic theory related to measure to geometry. But what is more surprising is that it is going to be interact with the topology. So this ergodic theoretical number is actually going to be a topological invariant. So this is going to be a crucial number. Everything is sort of in this number. All the complications, and you will see the complications or the surprises or are related to this average Jacobian. So this is a crucial number. And the first observation is that this number controls the contraction, the contracting directions. So, but now let me show you, and yesterday you saw already, the stable directions. So let me recall. So the characteristic exponent 0 corresponds to the stable directions in our counter set, but it also absolutely.
So this is more unstable.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, a neutral direction. Sorry, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So neutral direction, that's okay?
Sure.
No, you're absolutely right. The direction in which sort of distances don't change, the other direction will correspond to the contraction direction. So you should think about that. So there is all the tangent lines. You should think about them as tangent lines to this counter set. And of course, it takes some work to make sense out of that. But think about it like that. There is this counter set lying there, and it has tangent lines. And in the case, for an example, when the B is 0, then we just have a one-dimensional system, and the image is just the curve of our unimodal map, and this counter set is lying in this smooth curve. And so, and then if you take a point, then this neutral direction is really the tangent line to this smooth curve. And so this identification works perfectly in the degenerate case. So now you plot all these tangent lines, and you see they are going to form the envelope of the unimodal part of the map. So, and now I would like to. So, this is the picture. I can show you the picture for real. So, this is the real picture. So you see sort of an envelope of some parabola. So that is the picture when we are in the one-dimensional case. So now let's go just a little up to point one. So we turn on the two-dimensional aspect just a little bit, and then you get you get this. So you see, this is just like in the top of the page, you see point one. And so we just turn the B on a little bit. If you take 100, you would get quite a similar picture. And so what happens is, apparently, if you look at this top in the thing in the top, it's like a sort of a star. And that means that this counter set starts to twiggle a lot. So and this, so it becomes wild. And so it's not, it doesn't look at all that it is contained in some smooth curve. And all these tangent lines, they start to form stars, and these stars are sort of all over the place. There's a star there, and there are many stars. And so, and now if you go up a little bit more, I think to 0.4, so if you make everything a little bit more two-dimensional, you get this. And so this is for when the B is 0.4. And you see it starts to wind more and more and more. And this counter set gets crazier and crazier from a geometrical point of view. And even if you go up more, it starts to get really wild. Okay?
Does the theorem continue to hold for 0.4?
Excuse me?
The theorem is not hold for 0.4.
No, so this theorem, everything we do is perturbative. So our B is small. So this is a calculation. Sarma made these pictures.
But for B small, is the kind of set embeddable in some code?
We go there. That will be the next subject. And you're, of course, like if you look at this picture, this is for the, like a little bit, and you see stars already. So I at this moment, I wouldn't bet that for a hundredth you don't see stars. And so this picture, the message is going to be that if you perturb the one-dimensional Hendon map only a little bit, a billionth, a trillionth, the curve will break. And there's a theorem about that. So, yeah. So all these ones, so this curve, if you are looking in the curve of infinitely renormalizable maps. So that's the only place where we are looking.
But you don't actually know that explicitly. You're close to that. This is a finite
computation. Yeah. But we know that this curve exists. Yeah. And then we can do this experiment. It is an involved experiment. Of course, Sarma had to work hard to do that. But now there is a theorem. So let's explain these pictures with a theorem. This is again with the same group of people. And again, we look at infinite renormalizable maps with a small Jacobian. And that statement is that there is no continuous invariant line field on our guy. And you maybe don't get scared what is a line field. It means that it at each point of our counter set, we attach a line. And you see a picture here. So this is a line field. And the statement says that if you take the line field coming from neutral directions, like this picture, this is not continuous. This theorem, still there's complication going on. And a consequence of that, of course, is that if there is no invariant line field, it also means, I have to take it away. It also means that a consequence, our counter set is not contained in a smooth curve. So this answers Stefano's question. You cannot, there is this counter set lying here, and if you take B a trillionth, and for B a zero, it is clearly contained in a smooth curve. But now if you take B a billionth, then this curve breaks down and you cannot find a smooth curve. So these stars is really representing what is going on. There is a lot of twiggling going on. And that's it. Yeah, this picture is the picture of the oscillated line field. Absolutely. Absolutely. And it is measurable. But it is not continuous. It is really measurable. We come to that. There is something, but it is. I need some time to explain what is going on there.
But do you know if there are some places in which the neutral direction coincides with the stable direction, and you actually have?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. There is at least one point where that happens. Yeah. And that has to happen. For example, where we are zooming in with our renormalization will be a place where the stable direction and the where the counter set is going to be tangent to the stable direction. Exactly there, for example. But then it is all over the place. Okay? So, so from this we know that we really left 1D dynamics. And we are really doing two-dimensional dynamics. It's really it really involves the plane. Okay, so that looks all very scary, and you cannot deal with that. But let's start with a little good news, and that is by Michal Lubitsch and myself, that these counter sets are contained in a rectifiable curve. And a rectifiable curve is something which have finite lengths. On each scale, you have some finite lengths, but it can be very wiggly. But you can, there's a curve with a finite length, but where this thing lies in. So there's something, it's not completely crazy. Okay, so now, so this is a little good news. Let me tell you more good news. And let's give you two universality results. And it is a little sort of, it's going to be technical. It is going to be a formula. But this time there is sort of fun in the formula. If you look at the nth renormalization of such a map, it will look like something like this. Of course, in the bottom, we have an x. And then we have something unimodal. And this is something unimodal. And then there is something our average Jacobian starts to show up. And in a very precise way. So it's bf to the power 2 to the n, like no constants, b to the power 2 to the n. And then there is some analytic function which doesn't depend on anything. It's a universal analytic function. Then there is a y, and then there is an exponential small error. And so all this is universal. So what we see is that this fn converges exponentially to our unimodal fixed point. This function A is something analytic and universal. And universal in the sense it doesn't depend on the map you start with. Okay. Just a remark, you see the convergence of the unimodal part is exponential to the fixed point. And so this is clearly the main contribution to the renormalization. Because this is something super exponentially small. So we have something which is exponentially close to something we understand well. And then there is a super exponential perturbation. So that cannot play a role, you would say. So everything is going to happen inside here. Okay, so that is one universality theorem. There is another one. So this is all sort of the good news. Again, the same group. So, I remember we had our picture. Had a C1, and we had the box here, and then we had the new one, and we had the box here, and this is C2V, but then this one lands up somewhere here, and then there will be another box, and we zoom. And so you will see a sequence of boxes which are shrinking down to a point here. And so let's say this is the box BN, BVN, and this is the one B. You see a sequence of boxes shrinking down. This is the place, let me not put symbols. So this is the place where renormalization zooms in. And so our renormalizations, which are described in this very precise way, tell us something about like high iterates f to the 2 to the n on this little piece. But now there is the problem. So the renormalizations we understand very well, but of course these renormalizations are rescalings of this very high iterate by a composition of diffeomorphisms. So you know very well the behavior of the renormalization operator, but if you start to compose all these diffeomorphisms, it might become a mess. So it might be that all this precise information, in the end, is telling us nothing about what is going on here. And so this is the danger of using diffeomorphic rescalings and not affine rescalings. And so this is a delicate point. And you might say, yeah, because the picture blows up because these rescalings are not affine and they start to do crazy things. And it means that renormalization has nothing to do with what is going on here. The contrary is true. And it is going to be again a formula. And so let's take our map F and let's take our nth renormalization and let's take the diffeomorphism here which is used to rescale what you see, what F2 to the n is doing there. It's like the composition of all our diffeomorphisms. And then this rescaling has again a very precise form. It's sigma squared to the n. It's minus sigma to the n. Oh, sorry, it goes the other way around. Maybe it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It's one, it's some number, I will tell you what they are, times sigma squared to the n times minus sigma to the n. And then there is some diffeomorphic part, and there is just a y. And then an exponential error. So times 1 plus something exponential. So there is this formula describing how this rescaling happens. So let me tell you what these numbers are. So the sigma, what is the sigma? Now if you take the unimodal fixed point, and then we are looking at the domain of renormalization, and that has length sigma. So it's what they call the scaling ratio. So this number t, so in particular, it doesn't depend on f. It's a universal thing. This t depends on f. And you see this matrix, without this would be identity, but with a little t, it corresponds to a little tilt. And so this t is corresponding to some tilt. And it is proportional to our average Jacobian.
Okay. And then what else? I have to tell you about this function here. So this function SNX is going to be, it is a universal again, it is some analytic function, just depending on X, not depending on our original map, plus some number which does depend on F times Y squared, so it corresponds to some bending, and then plus some exponential small error. And so but what it means is that we had to consider the possibility that all this composition of this non-affine rescalings is something which is going to blow up. But apparently, that's not the case at all. It's going to converge to some universal diffeomorphism. So the scaling is not affine, but it is going to have a universal shape. Not depending on the map at all, except for this little tilt. So it's all very precise information and universal information. So let me tell you a bit more precise what happens in this. Let me show you what this picture is. And you will see what happens. So that picture, because of this tilt, of these scalings here, and because of this tilt, the little picture is going to look something like that. And where this is of the size sigma square to the n, and this is of the size sigma to the n, and then there is a tilt here, which is of the order of b. And so this picture is where your renormalization lives. So it's just a little tilted. And now, you know, in these boxes, there will be two copies of the next renormalization level. So what you will see is, if you, I tell you, and believe me, it's a simple, a very simple exercise. If you have this condition, that like the tilt times how sigma to the n, if that is proportional to sigma squared to the n, so if you have this condition, so this is the crucial condition. What will happen is that in this box, there are two boxes of the next scale. And that will look something like this. If you have this condition, they will be above each other. Under this condition. The two boxes inside, they used to be, like, they used to be, I don't have to, so they used to be something nice like that, two pieces next to each other, a little bit above each other. But if you have this relation between the Jacobian and the scaling, they will come exactly above each other. Something very simple, but it has a consequence. Because remember, when we introduced Hannon maps, the thing was that vertical lines are strongly contracted and then put somewhere. So now they are above each other. So if you now map these things, let me take the formula away because that's sort of, we don't need it anymore. So if you now just apply your map, so this picture, remember, is like this little box here. And now we just apply our map, and we will see something here. So and what you see there is that these two pieces are above each other, but they will be strongly contracted. So So what you will see is something like that. So they are very close compared to their size. So, and this is a bad picture. And like if you think one-dimensionally, this is a 2D picture. So in 1D, you would expect that it would be something nicely next to each other. In 1D, the pieces are always nicely next to each other, and the distance is comparable to the pieces. But now you see that the distance is actually much smaller compared to the size of the things. And so here you see the cause of the fact that there are no a priori bounds. And the geometry degenerates. So let me write down more precise statements about that. And now comes the bad news. So there's a theorem by Peter Hazard, Michal Lubitsch, and myself, which says the following. There exists some set A in the interval. It's a set, no dynamics. There's some set, and the Lebesgue measure is 1. And now the following happens. If your Jacobian of your map is in this set, so it's a purely a number theoretical condition, there is this a set of numbers. If your Jacobian falls in this set, then unbounded geometry. And that means that you can repeat this picture in smaller and smaller scale, and the pixels are getting closer and closer together, and bad stuff happens. It's not at all what you expect it to be if you think about the one-dimensional case. It is sort of interesting that it is purely a number theoretical condition. Now, let's say like this. let's think one-dimensional. And so then we are building up our counter set. Pieces and pieces, and pieces and pieces, and it continues forever. But now if you zoom in here, and then what you will see is some nice little interval, and there will be nice two pieces inside. So wherever you zoom in, you will see that all the pieces which are lying there, they are of comparable size. So nothing goes wrong. But now if you go to... So this is in 1D, so let me make this picture better. So now let's go to our non-map. And now here we have our one-dimensional counter set, which has a topological copy as invariant attractor of the Hendon map. So this is our counter set. So now if you would take the same spot here and you would zoom out, then it will happen that it doesn't look at all like this. So there will be pieces which have a certain size, that is the equivalent of this one, and there will be a piece which is the equivalent of that one, which is like really close. So the picture, the conjugation should bring this picture to that picture. These are the topological equivalent places. But the geometry here is very nice, just nice three pieces, nothing weird. But in the Hendon context, these pieces are screwed up. They are
they are sort of, they are folded.
So you're saying the
convex
is not
regular? No. That is the next theorem. So in the Hanon family, like in this family, B is just BF. It's the Jacobian. And so it is just, if you move along this parameter, then for almost every value of B, you will find unbounded geometry. But the curious thing is that this condition is just number theory. It has nothing to do with the fact that this is a curve in the Hanon family. There is number theory here. We don't know. We don't know. That's an open question. So we don't know. Everything we know is for tiny Jacobian. Not like very. It is like small. Okay. So let me answer Stefano's question, which is coming after this one. So the theorem is again the same group. If you have two maps which have different Jacobians, like take one here and take one here, maybe very close, then you see that there is a conjugation of the counter set from one to the counter set of the other. And now, hey, you're right. This is at most C a half to the 1 plus log BF1 divided by log BF2. And this is always smaller than 1. And so in particular, if you have, here we have our fixed point with our counter set, and here we have our map F with a certain positive Jacobian, and it has its counter set. So here we have our conjugation. And now, in this case, B is zero, so it becomes just C a half. This is at most. No. Yeah. So this map is at most C a half. So at most Hölder. So, hey, you turn on you have your very nice universal counter set. You turn on the B a ridiculously small amount. And the conjugation goes from C1 plus Hölder, what we were expected in the one-dimensional theory, suddenly to C and half. And so this picture is representing something. The counter set really is deformed tremendously. The conjugation jumps from C1 plus something into C and half. It's really a dramatic change. And this, like, B is zero to B positive. Okay, so it seems that everything breaks down. The whole theory breaks down. And at some point we told Feigenbaum about this result. And he said, this is not true. This cannot be true. Because universality and rigidity, that is the soul of our belief, of our renormalization, this cannot be true. So he did a measurement. He went to the computer and he started to measure the structure here. And we told him where he should look, and he found bad spots. But he also found good spots. So he found many good spots, but he also found bad spots. So let me try to make a theorem about that. And now the probability stuff comes in. And so if you just think about rigidity as we thought before, that the conjugation has to be differentiable on the attractor, and then you see that that notion of rigidity breaks down immediately. And you go from something differentiable to something which is at most Hölder. But there's something good happening. So it has to do with the scaling structure. So let's take, again, our unimodal fixed point. And let's take a little piece here out of the nth cycle. And we can blow this up. So we look under our microscope, and we see that this little piece is essentially a straight line. And inside here, there will be two other pieces. So there will be, let's call this I, and this we call IC, and this we call IV. As always, pieces have two pieces inside. And then we look at the scaling number of I, IC, is the length of the C interval divided by the length of C. It's like the scaling ratios which we discussed when we discussed the one-dimensional map. It's just the ratio of this is in the other one. And then there is also a scaling ratio for the other side, which is just the relative size. And you know, let me put a star here. And stars refer to things which are universal. And so these scaling ratios are the universal scaling ratios. And these are numbers, you remember, in the set of the counter set of scaling ratios of the fixed point. So these are universal numbers which you can measure. They are there. It's a rich set, but they are there. So now let's look at the same spot. Okay, let's use our conjugation. And let's look at the same spot in our Hannon counter set. So here we have our Hannon map, and we have our counter set. And like this little blob is going with the conjugation to some little blob here, something complicated. And let's zoom this out. And you cannot expect that it looks as nice as this. We know that sometimes it really goes bad. So let's measure how bad it is. How far is it away from this picture? So inside here you will see like the two blobs, which is like the C1, the equivalent of the C1 and the equivalent of the V1. I draw them sort of nice, but we don't know how they are. And let's measure how far they are from this. So what we can do is, to do that, we can draw around it some rectangle. And that rectangle will have a certain length, and it will have a certain thickness. As I'm trying to make a one-dimensional picture, but think about this H to be very small, but maybe it's not at all. And then you can cut off a little box measuring the size of this guy. And that we call sigma C times L. It's like the relative size of the length of this in the long box. And the same you can look at sigma V times L. So you measure three numbers, which sort of describe the geometry of this piece. So you get an H, which measures how thick the thing is. You measure a sigma, which measures how long this guy is, and you measure how long this guy relatively is. And now you say, here we have our piece I. This is the definition. So epsilon is epsilon standard if the picture differ by epsilon. So if H is smaller than epsilon,
and if the scaling ratios which you measure in the Hanon are epsilon close to what they are supposed to be, if there would be one domain, if there would be a rigidity. And this should be smaller than epsilon. And now you also measure the other one. And you also want this to be smaller than epsilon. And so if epsilon is very tiny, it means that this picture really looks like that. So standard pieces are like one-dimensional pieces. And now there is a theorem about this. About how many there are. And there the probabilistic aspect of universality comes in. So this theorem is called probabilistic universality. So what you do is you collect all the pieces where epsilon I in the end cycle, which are epsilon standard. So these are all the good pieces, the epsilon good pieces, on the nth construction of the counter set. And now the statement is that there exists some number theta, smaller than one, which is a universal number. And what we know about this, that if you take the measure of all the good pieces, and good pieces which are exponentially good, so you take all the pieces at the nth level of the cycle, which are really exponentially close to what you want it to be, what it would be in the one-dimensional context. And now you take the measure of those guys. You count them. And that is larger than 1 minus theta to the n. And so we know that there are bad pieces, which is indicated by all these stars. We know there are bad pieces. But the bad pieces only form an exponential small fraction of all of them. So if you go deep enough, then most of the pieces will just look one-dimensional. So from a probabilistic point of view, the counter set, which is deformed, there are really bad pieces, but from a probabilistic point of view, they didn't deform. So, and that is like the other theorem, and to finish, and that answers Stefano's first question. It is also by Michal Lubitsch and myself. That is called probabilistic rigidity. So now we are going to speak about the quality of this conjugation. So we have our universal counter set, and we have our real counter set, and there's a conjugation, and we would like to know the quality of that. So we know that it is only C a half. So we cannot just say it is good, something good. But what we know is that there exists a sequence of sets in the counter set of our map. And what we know is that the measure goes to one. So you start to fill up the counter set. You start to take, there are places where the stars and you throw the stars out. And you go to find, that's what you do. You throw out the bad stuff on each scale. And then what we know is if you look at the conjugation from this xn to its image in the unimodal world, this is C1 plus beta. And again, there exists a universal Hölder constant, and on this subset, the conjugation is differentiable. And so rigidity breaks down. Have we proved that if you perturb, if you take your unimodal map and you push it a little bit into the Hanon world, the conjugation breaks down and becomes CAF. But from a probabilistic point of view, everything is fine and it continues to be C1 plus beta. So rigidity survives in a probabilistic sense. Let's go home.
How fast norm is growing?
Excuse me?
So you have this H from Excel, which you mentioned. Yes, it's C1 plus.
Yeah.
Yes, it's C1 plus beta. But there is C1 plus beta norm.
Yeah. So the exponent is fixed, but the Hölder norm grows, and I think it grows exponentially. I'm not 100% sure. I think it grows exponentially. Yeah. I don't. Yeah, but you know, there is something nice. There is some. You know, remember when we had. So I don't know the answer, but we have the technique to calculate this norm. We know very precisely how these things look like. And a remark, I remember that there was thing about you have to choose the Jacobian according to number theoretical conditions of the Jacobian, and that will make the geometry unbounded. So these sets, they have a topological construction. And the way they are constructed depends only on this average Jacobian. So if you take two maps with the same average Jacobian, the conjugation will identify these sets. So these are not arbitrary sets. There is a lot of structure here. And they are topologically defined by. And that is the strange things. They are topological. It's all contradictory. They are topologically defined by a measure theoretical invariant. It's crazy. But that's how it works. Okay?